68.3 FM Friday morning. 7 minutes at the top of the hour, that will be at 7. The 25th day of the month of June 2022 happens to be the last Friday of the month of June 2021. A very good morning greetings to each and every single soul doing the lesson right here, right now. Another beautiful day. We are live. I say glory be to God. Welcome to Wednesday Morning Express. Time for us to bring you radio lecture for this morning is for all level handed students. Send the course GPDR 111 communication skills, and the topic is grammar and usage, concord relations, with your lecturer Miss Gloria Baffo from the Department of Communication and Media Studies, University Education, Winneba. Still lines will be activated for you to be part of the lecture. 0503923158 and 0332320201. Test on WhatsApp is 0503923158. We'll be streaming live on Facebook. That's Radio Indy 98.3 FM. And we'll also broadcast live on the university homepage. That's www.ue.ed.gh. Without much ado, let me hand over the baton to Madam Gloria as she presents this morning's radio lecture on the topic grammar and usage, concord relations. For all level-headed students, study the course GPDR 111 communication skills. Gloria, good morning. Good to see you.
Good morning, sweetheart. Good to see you too.
Great. I hope you're doing well.
Yes, please. By God's grace and you.
By His grace too.
Good.
Level-headed students are ready this morning for the lecture.
That's fine. And I'm also ready to lecture them. All right. So let's go on. So, bonjour. Today I'm using French. Bonjour to you all, good people of the university community, the people of Winneba and its environs listening to me this morning. This is Gloria Ahima Baffo, as you are being told, from the Department of Communication and Media Studies. On the seat to take you through the topic for today, concord relations in English, or subject-verb agreements in English. So, Holy Spirit, my friend, I humbly ask for your presence and direction throughout this lecture. Please help my listeners to follow keenly and understand what is taught today, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. Good. Before we delve into the lecture, I have some sentences I've put down, and I would like you to pick the correct answers in these three sentences I'm going to tell you. Example one, the box on the table belongs to my siblings. The box, plural, on the table belongs to my siblings. Two, the box, plural again, on the table belong to my siblings. The box on the table belong to my siblings. Then a third one is, the apple on the table is mine. Have you put down your correct answers already? Well, if you have, kindly hang on with your answers because we'll come back to them in a bit, okay? What then is subject-verb agreement? What is subject-verb agreement? Subject-verb agreement refers to the special way in which a subject and verb work together to make a sentence correct. A special way in which a subject and verb work together to make a sentence correct. In simple terms, the subject and the verb have to come along like friends do. You know, friends are buddies, all right? So most times they come along. That's how subject-verb agreement is. They must always agree. There should be harmony between them. What does it mean? It means that if the subject is singular, the verb must also be singular. And if the subject is plural, the verb must definitely be plural too. I'm saying it again. The important rule you must note about subject-verb agreements is that if the subject is singular, the verb must also be singular. And if the subject is plural, the verb must be plural too. So this takes us back to the question I asked earlier when I introduced the topic. Sentence one said, the box on the table belongs to my siblings. Sentence two, the box on the table belong to my siblings. Then the third sentence, which is the last one, says, the apple on the table is mine. So which of the sentences are correct according to the rules we just learnt? Is it question one or question two and three? Yes. Have you ticked them already? One, two, and three. Okay. So the correct answers are question two and three. Is that what you wrote? Very good. You realize that because the question two, the subjects which are the books are plural, the verb is also plural. In question three also, the subject, apple, is singular. So the verb is also singular. This is all you need to know or you need to understand about subject-verb agreements. For we're also going to use the same rules you just heard pertaining to this topic to explain the other rules under it. Okay? So now let's go to the third rule, because the singular and the plural are the first two rules. Now we are going to the third rule. The use of a title in subject-verb agreements. The use of a title in subject-verb agreements. Titles of books, novels, movies, television programs, musical compositions, newspapers, among others, take the singular form of the verb. I'm taking that again. Titles of books, novels, movies, television programs, musical compositions, newspapers, among others, take the singular form of the verb. So here are some examples. Example one, Thy Grace is a song recently released by Kofi Kinata. You remember that song? Erasing your wanche. It's a good song, and I entreat you to listen. You'd love it. So Thy Grace is a title, and it's a song recently released by Kofi Kinata. Because it's a title, that is why we use the singular verb is. Romeo and Juliet is a tragic love story I read when I was in senior high school. Romeo and Juliet is a tragic story. Tragic love story I read when I was in senior high school. So Romeo and Juliet is the title of the story. And because of the title, we use the singular verb is. Now we move on to rule number four. Using pseudo conjunction and in subject verb agreements. Pseudo conjunction and in subject verb agreements. When two singular nouns or subjects are two separate entities, are joined by the coordinator and. The plural verb must be used. Again, when two singular nouns or subjects or two separate entities are joined by the coordinator and, A-N-D, the plural verb must be used. For example, the teacher and her son are walking on the pavement. The teacher and her son are walking on the pavement. So in this sentence, the teacher, who is a subject or an entity, has been joined together with another subject or entity, her son. They have become two now. That is why the verb are is used. Let's take another example. The man and the secretary. The man and the secretary are my neighbors. The man and the secretary are my neighbors. The man is an entity. The secretary is an entity, also an entity, joined by and, A-N-D. So they require, that sentence require a plural verb. However, when two or more subjects joined by the conjunction and, A-N-D, refer to the same person or entity, the singular verb is used. Please pay attention here. When two or more subjects joined by the conjunction AND refer to the same entity or the same person, the singular verb is used. Let's look at these examples. Our mother and teacher is very hardworking. Our mother and teacher is very hardworking. In this sentence, we are talking about our mother, who is at the same time a teacher, and not our mother and another teacher. So because it is our mother who is at the same time a teacher, the singular verb is has been used. Let's take another example again. The player and musician was arrested yesterday at the museum. The player and musician was arrested yesterday at the museum. In this sentence also, we refer to the player who is also a musician that was arrested in the museum, and not two individuals, the player and a musician. So because it's the same person, we have used the singular verb was. So what differentiates the first two examples I gave and the three and four are what we call determinants, where we have the article a and where we have the there, he, her, his, and all that. So in this sentence, what differentiates between them is the use of the for the man and the secretary, and then the use of her for the first sentence, which is the teacher and her son are walking the pavement. The teacher has the determinant there, her son too, which is another entity, has the determinant her. Sorry, it's yes, her. Very good. My mind was just reading fast and okay, so that's it for this one. Don't confuse yourself. I'm sure by now you've been able to understand, but if you still don't understand, we'll still go by it during questioning time. Okay, rule 5, quasi-pseudo-coordinators. So, quasi-pseudo-coordinators are words or phrases which cannot join two singular nouns to make them plural. Quasi-pseudo-coordinators are words or phrases which cannot join two singular nouns to make them plural. The verb chosen depends on the subject the coordinators immediately follow. The verb chosen depends on the subject the coordinators immediately follow. If the coordinator immediately follows a singular subject, a singular verb is used. If the coordinator immediately follows a singular subject, a singular verb is used. If the coordinator follows a plural subject, a plural verb is also preferred. So here are the pseudo coordinators you may pay attention to. Together with, as well as, in addition to, with, accompanied by, along with, including, like, no less than, rather than, apart from, and with the exception of. I'd like to go over them again. Together with, as well as, in addition to, with, accompanied by, along with, including, like, no less than, rather than, apart from, and with the exception of. Now let's take this example. The woman with her children was given a warm reception at the party. The woman with her children was given a warm reception at the party. Now in this sentence, let's try to identify the subject. So we can have the woman as a subject and her children too. How about the coordinator in the sentence? Yes? With. Very good. So which subject does the coordinator with immediately follow? Which subject does the coordinator with immediately follow? The woman. Excellent. Is the subject the woman, singular or plural? Singular. Good job. So per the rule, if the coordinator immediately follows a singular subject, a singular verb is required. So are we right to say that the woman with her children was given a warm reception at the party is correct? Are we right to say that? Are we right to say that the woman with her children was given a warm reception at the party? Very good. Now let's take this next example. I'm going to use the same example, but this time in the plural form, okay? So that you'll not be confused. I just want you to get the rule. The women with their children were given a warm reception at the party. The women with their children were given a warm reception at the party. Here, because the coordinator with immediately follows the plural subject women, the plural verb were has been used. So always remember that when the coordinator immediately follows a singular subject, a singular noun is used. And when it follows a plural subject, a plural verb is also used, okay? Now let's move on to rule number 6. At this moment, I'm very, very sure you are following the lecture. Rule number 6. Singular nouns with plural verbs. Singular nouns with plural verbs. So some singular nouns look plural because they end with a plural marker S. These are considered singular and take singular verbs because they name single things such as one area of knowledge or one type of disease. I'm going over again. Some singular nouns look plural because they end with the plural marker S. These are considered singular and take singular verbs because they name singular things such as one area of knowledge or one type of disease. Examples of such nouns include economics, civics, mathematics, linguistics, measles, rabies, among others. You should, however, note that the following: information, music, clothing, furniture, news. Why do people say news? The correct pronunciation is news, okay? Equipment, not equipment, equipment, luggage, aid, evidence, knowledge, stationery, among others, are generally found in the singular form and therefore take singular verbs. So let's now take some examples. Example 1. Music is good for the soul. Music is good for the soul. I would have sung when if I were to be in the classroom. Should I sing? The information, example 2, the information that you shared on Facebook this morning is incomprehensible. The information you shared on your Facebook wall this morning is incomprehensible. Then the third example is, the equipment in the storeroom is outdated. The equipment in the storeroom is outdated. You realize that all these examples, the singular verb was used, okay? Right. Now we'll go to notional concord. Notional concord. Rule number 7 in subject verb agreement. Notional concord. And the notional concord, we consider the relationship between collective nouns and their verbs. A collective noun is a noun used to refer a group of people or things. A collective noun is a noun used to refer a group of people or things. Example, committee, team, family, among others. So with collective nouns, the context determines whether the verb is singular or plural. The context determines whether the verb is singular or plural. If the noun is taken as a unit or a group, the singular verb is used. Please pay attention to this one. In notional concord, if the noun is taken as a unit or a group, the singular verb is used. But if the members in the group are seen as separate, or the emphasis in that context is placed on the individual members in the group, the plural verb is used. During your conversation, if you are considering the individual members in the group, the plural verb is used when it comes to notional concord. So let's take these examples. Example one. The committee meets twice in a year. The committee meets twice in a year. In this sentence, the committee is considered as a unit. That is why the singular verb has been used. Example two. The class is meeting today. The class is meeting today. In this example also, the class is considered as a unit. But if I immediately change this sentence I just made to the class are meeting today. I'm sure some people are rolling their eyes. What is madam saying? The class are meeting? The class are meeting today. Then it immediately signifies that the individual members in this class are being referred to. And so we use the plural verb are. I hope you understand. All right. I'm sure I'm not going to get any question on this one because I've taken my time to explain. Oh. Okay, so rule number 8, proximity concord. How to use proximity concord in subject verb agreements. When two subjects, one of which is singular and the other plural, are joined by either or, neither nor, not only, but also, the verb agrees with the subject very close to it. Please, I'm taking this again. When two subjects, one of which is singular and the other plural, are joined together by either or, neither nor, not only, but also, the verb agrees with the subject very close to it. Here are some examples. Either the children or the parent has to be present in the meeting. Either the children or the parent has to be present in the meeting. Example two. Either the parent or the children have to be present in the meeting. Either the parent or the children have to be present in the meeting. In the first example, the verb has is selected because it is closer to the second singular subject, the parent. So either the children or the parents, which is singular, okay, has to be present. And because the parent is the second subject in this sentence, the verb has, which is closer to the parent, has been used. In the second example also, the verb have is selected because have is closer to the second plural, the plural subject, the children. Just note that when either or, neither nor, not only, but also are used, or when they are used to join two subjects, one which is singular and the other plural, the verb agrees with the subject that is very close to it. That's all. So when you are doing any exercise on this, just look for the verb, that the subject that is closer to the verb, and choose your answer. Don't confuse yourself. Always look for the subject that is closer to the verb. So if it is singular, choose a singular verb. If it is plural, choose a plural verb. Okay? Now we go to rule number 9. Intervening words and phrases in subject-verb agreements. Intervening words and phrases used in subject-verb agreements. Sometimes, intervening words and phrases, such as prepositional phrases, come between the true subject and its verb. Sometimes, intervening words and phrases, such as prepositional phrases, come between the true subject and its verb. Please let's look at these two examples to explain or to get them better. The books, example one, the books on the table are mine. They are simple sentences because I want to use simple sentences so that you can understand clearly. The books on the table are mine. So what is the true subject in this sentence? The true subject is the box. The box, not the book, so the box. Then the prepositional phrase is on the table. On the table. So you will notice that, okay, let me give you the second one before I can continue. The second example is, the meeting between the pastor and the church members has been cancelled. The meeting between the pastor and the church members has been cancelled. The meeting is a true subject. The prepositional phrase, between the pastor and the church members. The verb here is has. Okay, good. So you'll notice in example one that although the prepositional phrase on the table comes between the true subject and the verb are agrees with the subject, the books. The prepositional phrase in that sentence adds more information to the subject, therefore can be omitted and the sentence will still be meaningful. So let's take it this way. The books on the table are mine. If I decide to omit on the table and then say the sentence again, it will be like, the books are mine. And so because the books is books are plural, we use the plural verb are. Are you okay? In sentence two also, the true subject, the meeting is singular, so the verb has is chosen. So let's take the phrase from the sentence. The meeting between the pastor and the church members has been canceled. Now I'm going to take the prepositional phrase from there. So it will be something like, the meeting has been canceled. The meeting has been canceled. I've taken the prepositional phrase out. The sentence is still meaningful. And I chose the meeting, the verb has, because the meeting is singular. Okay. Good. We move on to rule number 10. Indefinite pronouns. Indefinite pronouns. Indefinite pronouns that end with one, body, and thing. With examples like someone, everyone, no one, somebody, everybody, nobody, anything, something, and nothing are always singular and require singular verbs. Please, I'm repeating. indefinite pronouns that end with one, body, and thing, with examples like someone, everyone, no one, somebody, everybody, nobody, anything, something, and nothing are always singular and require singular verbs. Aside that, each, much, other, either, little, etc., are all indefinite singular nouns and must agree with singular verbs. Each, much, either, little, among others, are all indefinite singular nouns and must agree with singular verbs. So let's take the examples under these indefinite pronoun subject verb agreements. Example one. Neither of the contestants is present. Neither of the contestants is present. Each of us was given a handsome reward. One of the students has been hospitalized. Indefinite pronouns such as several, others, many, a few, and few are both always plural and require plural verbs. Indefinite pronouns such as several, others, many, a few, few, and both are always plural and require plural verbs. So somebody will ask me, Madam, what is the difference between few and a few? So a few means some, whereas few means not a lot of. A few means some. And then few means not a lot of. Okay. So few boys can cook very well. Meaning not a lot of boys can cook very well. Are you getting it? Good. Let's use both in the one sentence. Both girls are intelligent. So both is always plural and requires a plural subject. Okay. Sometimes some indefinite pronouns such as any, all, most, more, none, and some can either be singular or plural depending on the context they are used. Please, I'm taking it again. Sometimes indefinite pronouns such as any, all, most, more, none, and some can either be singular or plural depending on the context they are used. The choice of appropriate verb depends on whether they precede countable or uncountable nouns. The choice of the appropriate words, okay, appropriate verb, depends on whether they precede countable or uncountable nouns. So when they precede countable nouns, they take plural verbs. Those pronouns I mentioned, when they precede countable nouns, they take plural verbs. For example, most of the footballers are from Africa. Most of the footballers are from Africa. Footballers are countable. That is why we use the verb are. Example 2. Some of the tables are broken. Some of the tables are broken. Tables are also countable nouns, so definitely we will use the plural verb are. But when the indefinite pronouns I mentioned early on precede uncountable nouns, they agree with singular verbs. When they precede uncountable nouns, they agree with singular verbs. Let's take two examples. So, example one. Most of the luggage in the bus is missing. Luggage is uncountable. So, the singular verb is used. All the water from the tank has drained out. All the water from the tank has drained out. Water is uncountable. Can you count water? Water is uncountable. Therefore, the singular verb has is also used here. Now, I want us to look at this expression. Expressions of time, money, and distance. So, expressions of time, money, and distance usually take singular verbs. Expressions of time, money, and distance usually take singular verbs. For example, 10,000 cedis is a great deal of money. 10,000 cedis is a great deal of money, isn't it? If I give you 10,000 cedis right now, you can use it to do a whole lot of things, right? Okay, so example 2. 5 kilometers is too far to walk. 5 kilometers is too far to walk. I'm very tired. I can't move on again, mommy. 5 kilometers is too far to walk. That's a little girl crying to mommy, right? Example 3. 10 years is too long to finish the project. 10 years is too long to finish the project. Okay, so we now move to the very last rule for today's lecture. Nouns consisting of two parts. Nouns consisting of two parts in subject-verb agreements. Nouns that have two parts, like scissors, shorts, trousers, jeans, handcuffs, spectacles, etc., require plural verbs. Do you have scissors in your room right now? Take it and hold it. It has two parts. When you take your pair of trousers, hold it. You see that it has two parts. Good. So we are saying that nouns that have two parts, like scissors, shorts, trousers, jeans, handcuffs, spectacles, etc., require plural verbs. So let's look at some examples. Example 1. My jeans that mommy bought for me just yesterday are too faded. I was looking for something nicer than mommy did, but mommy has tried. So mommy, thank you. So the sentence is, my jeans are too faded. Two parts. My jeans are too faded. Example 2. The scissors for the demonstration need to be kept safe. The scissors for the demonstration need to be kept safe. However, note that we use a pair of with a singular verb if we want to refer to one of such items. Let's say you have a lot of scissors in your room. You want to refer to one. Then the pair of will come in here. Okay? The same applies to the other nouns I mentioned. So, we have an example like, my pair of jeans is too faded. This one, this time round, it's not my pair of jeans are faded. It's not my jeans are faded. It is my pair of jeans is faded. Okay? Then a second example. The pair of scissors for the demonstration needs to be kept safe. The pair of scissors for the demonstration needs to be kept safe. Because of the pair of the verb is singular, so needs. Then the last example. A pair of spectacles has bright colors. A pair of spectacles has bright colors. So too soon, we've come to the end of our lecture. It's now time for you to ask questions on what you've learned so far. If you heard anything that was not clear to you, this is a time you should take your phone to call this number, 0503-923158. 0503-923158. You can also WhatsApp or send SMS message to the same number, 0503-923158. The phone lines are opened and you can call. I'm waiting for you. Is there a caller on the line?
Yes.
Okay. Please mention your name. Please hold on, my gentleman. Please mention your name and the department you are calling from and the level as well. Thank you.
Yes, I'm in level 100. My name is Abraham, Geography Department.
Okay.
Yes. Please, you talked about the Central Bone Downs and you had an example like all the footballers are from Africa.
Yes.
So please have to ask if it goes to the water bodies. So say all the water bodies. So we say are in Africa or
all right.
It's in Africa.
So all can be used in both plural and singular form, depending on the context you are using. So all the footballers, you know, footballers, I can count them. That is why I said footballers are. Okay. So water bodies, is it singular or plural? Tell me. Oh, are you there? He's gone. Water bodies, it looks like it's collective, right? So we'll use the singular verb, is. Are you okay? You are gone. All right. So we are still waiting for you to call. The line are still opened. Oh, okay, there's a call on the line.
Hello.
Yes.
Good morning.
Hello, good morning. How are you?
By the grace of God, I'm doing well. My name is Edmond from Economics Department.
Yes, please.
Madam, with the first rule of Concord, we said that singular nouns take singular verb.
Yes.
And the noun, there is a question that I want to ask, that is using the noun God.
God.
We know that, yes, it's a singular, but most of the times we say, God, have mercy on us. So I want to clarify whether it is a correct sentence or not.
Okay. So there is a pronoun that has been taken out of it. The sentence should actually look like, you, God, have mercy on us. You, God, have mercy on us. But the personal pronoun, which is the second person, you, takes the takes have. That is why we say God have mercy and not God has mercy. You have. So God, you have mercy on us. That's it. Do we still have callers on the line? Okay, so the line is 0503 923158. 3158. You can ask, okay, hello.
Hello, good morning.
Good morning. Can you lower the volume of the radio for us?
Yeah, I'm Emmanuel.
Emmanuel.
Danko from Special Education Department.
Okay, Emmanuel.
Okay, madam, please, rule 7.
Rule 7.
Mm-hmm. He said something like, the class is meeting, and later he said, class meeting.
Okay.
Madam, please, can you say the members of the class are meeting? Can you say that one?
Definitely, yeah, you can seven. Say. Can I? Can I understand? Definitely, you can say the members. What did you say? The members of the class, right? Members of the class are meeting. Yeah. Now you are talking about the individual members. Not the whole group. And because you are talking about the individual members, the plural verb must be used. Okay? That is all about notional concord. Notional concord talks about units and group of members or individual members, depending on the context that you find yourself in. So if whatever you are talking about is in a unit, whatever that you are being we are referring to is a unit, the singular verb is used. If you are talking about individual things or individual members, then the plural verb is used. Okay, good. Okay, the phone numbers again. 0503-923158. You can still WhatsApp us or send us messages and we'll attend to them. So we are waiting for you to call or send us messages. 5 8.3 FM. Okay, so I have a message from Patrick. Patrick says, good morning, madam. I am Patrick from Music Department, level 100. If I understand very well, anytime a particular subject does not agree with a verb in a sentence, the sentence becomes wrong. Please, is it that case? I'm reading your question again. If I understand very well, anytime a particular subject does not agree with a verb in a sentence, the sentence becomes wrong. Please, is that the case? Patrick, it is so. Your verb, I remember I told you at the beginning that they are like buddies, they are like friends. There should be harmony. There should be agreement. So a plural verb should always agree with a plural subject. and a singular verb should always agree with a singular subject. Thank you. Hello.
Hello, good morning, madam.
Good morning, sweetheart. Can you lower the volume of your radio? Or you can easily move away from it.
My name is Abubakar Mashu from Polycarp and Bansu.
Yes, Abubakar, yes.
This madam, on room number 7, you said, you said an example that cloud is meeting today, and later on the cloud are meeting today, so that you can use the two depending on what the attention is, whether on the members in the class or maybe the class as a unit. But if this one question, how do you know that the attention is on the members or the class as a unit?
Abdullahi, I would like you to call again using 0503-923158 because it wasn't clear and I couldn't hear you well. 0503-923158. Let me attend to the question somebody has just sent. This is from Abdullahi from Social Studies Department. Please, madam, where and what? It's confusing me. I want you to talk about it for me. Abdullahi, what and where are all parts of the verb to be? We have the verb to be am, so we say I am, okay? And then we have is, he is, okay? And then so is, what is the past tense of is, okay? So she's here. If I want to say that, if I want to tell somebody that, oh, that friend came here yesterday, I will say she was here yesterday. Was being a singular verb in this sentence because the subject she is singular. Now, if I change it to the where is the plural of the verb was? So if I want to change the sentence, I would say they were here yesterday. Abdullahi, I hope you are okay with this one. Okay. Oko Richmond from Counseling Psychology Department says, Madam, I want a clarification on the proximity concord and intervening words or phrases. Thank you. So, Richmond, when it comes to proximity concord, when two subjects, one which is singular and the other plural, are joined by either or, neither nor, not only, but also, the verb agrees with the subject very close to it. So two subjects, we have one, esi, then another subject, the children. Esi is singular. The children is plural. When they are joined by either or, let's say they are joined by either or, the subject that is closer to the verb, okay, determines the verb that should be used. So, if in a sentence like, Esi or either AC or the children have to be present. I choose have because the children is closer to the verb. So all the time, look for the indicator. If the indicator is plural, the one that is closer to the verb. If it is plural, choose a plural verb. If it is singular, choose a singular verb. If I should interchange this sentence I just used again, either the children or Essie has to be present in the meeting. The verb that is closer to the subject that is closer to the verb is Essie. Essie is singular. That is why has is chosen here. Now, when it comes to the intervening words, we say that intervening words are prepositional phrases. You know what prepositional phrases are? The use of at, on, under, between, and all that. When we have prepositional phrases, between a subject, okay, a subject and a verb, the prepositional phrase do not determine the verb to be used. I told the prepositions, examples of prepositions are of, at, under, blah, 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 you know. So when they are used in a phrase, like the pencils under the table are broken, the pencils under the table are broken. Here, the intervening word is under, intervening words or phrases is under the table. If I take under the table from the word, you have from the phrase or sentence, you have something like the pencils are broken. You will choose a because you already know that pencils are plural. The intervening phrases in the sentence is just there to add information. It's just there to describe where the pencils are. So it doesn't have it doesn't determine the verb that you should choose in the sentence, okay? I hope you are okay this time round. So this is from Isaac Etenam. I hope I'll get this name right. I'm sorry if I pronounce it wrongly. I'm sorry, okay? You are from Political Science Department. And you are telling me that you thank me for my time. But your first question is, what is the difference between uncountable nouns and uncount nouns? The non-count nouns is the same as uncountable nouns, okay? Then your second question is, the pair of jeans is dirty. Can I as well say the pairs of jeans are dirty? No, please. I told you that the moment you use a pair of, it becomes singular. If you don't use the pair, then you take the plural verb. Okay, thank you. Hello. Okay, so I would like to give the phone number again so that you can still be calling if you can't send messages. 0503-923-1585. Please do call. I am here waiting for you. Let's address a message somebody just sent. Good morning, madam. Noel, righteous, Adam, from Spared. Please, in Rule 8, which is proximity concord, can we say that the verb agrees with the subject that it immediately follows? Yes, 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 righteous. Okay, so anytime you want to choose your answer, look for the subject that is close to the verb. All right. Okay, thank you. My dear caller on the line, good morning. Can you lower the radio set for us, please, or move away from it, please?
Oh, okay.
Thank you. So,
presentation.
Hello? Please lower the volume of your radio set, or kindly move away from it, please.
Oh, okay.
Wow, sweethearts. You want to hear your voice on radio? Well, that's why I'm sure you're not moving away.
I'm moving.
Please move away, okay? Otherwise, okay. I can't hear your question.
Okay. My name is Prosper Onyefia Adu.
Okay, Prosper.
Department of Art Education.
Okay.
Yeah, from your presentation, you said the class is meeting. And then the class are meeting.
Mm-hmm.
Both are correct.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to find out if three classes are meeting. Will it be still the class is meeting or the class are meeting?
So in your perception or in your view, are you talking about the individual members in the class? If you're talking about the individual members in the class, then you will use are meeting. Okay.
Okay. Can you
listen to me? Well, you're talking about three classes. So one class as a unit.
Okay.
One class as a unit will take the S.
Okay.
The moment you are talking about I, it means you're talking about the people inside, the members in. That's all.
Okay.
All right. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Mm. Bye.
Bye. Over the lines again. 0503-923-1585.
0503-923-1585.
Hello, do I have a call on the line?
Hello, good morning,
madam. Good morning, my sweetheart.
My name is Abu Akar.
Your name again?
Abubakar Mashi from Bosca Family Department.
Okay.
Please, madam, my question is still on the rule number 7.
Mm-hmm.
Other examples, as you can say, the class is meeting.
Mm-hmm.
It's correct. The class are meeting. That one too is correct. Depends on your attention, whether it's on the class as a unit or the individual members.
Yes, please.
And my question is, if this thing drops in quiz, probably you use and it as options. So how would I know that your attention is on whether on the class as a unit or the individual members in it?
The question will be posed in such a way that you know what to pick, please. Thank you. Thank you. So we are still waiting for you to call 0503-923158. Hello.
Hello. Good morning, madam.
Good morning, dear. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you, madam.
All right.
Please, this is Jonathan Aberin from Special Education Department. Hello.
I'm listening, please, Jonathan.
Please, madam, we appreciate the way you lecture us this morning.
All right, thank you very much.
Everything is clear.
Thank you.
But before my questions come, it's like you are Steve.
Oh.
So next time, maybe you can reduce your speed for us.
Wow. I hear you, my sweetheart. Next time, I'll talk like... I'll just move like the pace of a snail.
And my question is, madam.
Yes.
Do we have a sentence that we can use a singular to conclude the sentence, the singular verb to conclude the sentence, or the plural verb to conclude the sentence?
Please give me an example.
Example. Mm-hmm. If no, why, madam?
Oh, please give me an example, because actually, I didn't understand your question.
I am saying, do we have a sentence that we can use a singular verb to conclude the sentences, or a plural verb to conclude the sentences? If yes, example. If no, why we don't have sentences like that?
Please give me an example. Maybe I'll use that to explain, because I actually don't understand you. So please write down an example and call back 0503-923158, and I'll use the example to explain. Okay, thank you.
Madam, good morning.
Good morning, my dear.
I'm Isaac from Political Science Department, Level 100.
Political Science. May I hear you?
Madam, please, my question is, I want to know whether there will there be a situation where you have one sentence with one verb closer to the subject and then another verb after the subject. Would it be a sentence of that on that
question
subject?
Question again.
I want to know that will it be a sentence? A sentence is that you have a verb closer to the subject, and then after the subject, you have another verb.
Well, if you can give me an example, it would be very, very helpful to me. But
okay,
talk.
Actually, I don't have another. I wanted to know whether there can be a sentence of that sort.
I think you are still talking about proximity concord.
Yeah, that's the proximity. My question
is proximity is about distance. So we still talk about what is closer to the subject. So every time you want to choose your answer, if the subject is closer to the verb, just pick your answer. Look at the subject. Is it plural or singular? If it's plural, you take the plural verb. It is singular to the singular verb, okay?
Okay.
Good.
Thank you.
Welcome, my dear. Good morning, madam. There's an SMS. My name is Ayise Clinton. And my question is about the name Jesus. How do we use it in grammar construction? And under which rule does it fall? Well, we all know that when Jesus came on this earth, Jesus was a man. And Jesus is always a person who is singular. So when we are using it in a sentence, definitely we will use a singular verb. So, Jesus is my friend. Jesus is singular, a singular subject. So the singular word, the singular verb is used here, okay? All right. Is also from Andrews Adai. Andrews is from the graphic design department. Anna says, good morning, madam. Please, with the rule number 5, which is on quasi or pseudo coordinators, I want to ask, can a verb be singular when the subject is singular and vice versa? So, in quasi or pseudo coordinators, I introduced you to some indicators together with exception of, and among others. I told you that the verb is with the coordinator that the subject agrees, okay, with the coordinator that immediately follows it. So in this instance, you have to look for the coordinator, whether it is with, whether it's together with. You have to know the subject is immediately following. So if the subject is singular, as he said here, the verb is singular. If the subject is plural, the verb also be plural. I have a caller on the line. Hello, sweetheart. Good morning. How are you?
I'm fine.
I'm also fine. Thank you. Your question, please. Hello. Please, your name again.
Divine
favor.
And let's say you have a sentence, and there is a comma before the conjunction. For instance, the man, comma, and the secretary. I mean, this situation, what verb are we supposed to use? Is it in the singular or the plural form?
Okay. We learned that when you join two singular subjects with and, the plural is used. There's a comma by the man, but the man is an entity on its own. It's a subject. Then the secretary is also a subject. So two coming together. So if they do, definitely I'll choose the plural. Okay, good. WhatsApp platform now, and Benedict from SOSA Department. SOSA. SOSA Department is asking, please, can I say the cabinet is meeting today? Yes, my dear. You can say the cabinet is meeting today. Here, I can see that the cabinet is seen as a unit. That is why you are using is. So you are definitely correct, okay? Thank you. So we have one from Samuel Saki from Arts Education Department. He says, please, madam, can you throw more light on the rule number 9, intervening words and phrases? Okay. So, Samuel, rule number 9. We say that sometimes intervening words and phrases, such as prepositional phrases, come between the true subject and its verb. So in a sentence, we have a subject and a verb. Put that in mind. In a sentence, we have a subject and a verb. But in between the subject and the verb, there is a prepositional phrase. The prepositional phrase in there is just to add more information to the subject. It doesn't show you the kind of verb take. So if I say, the woman in the black dress is my mother. The woman in the black dress is my mother. In the black dress, the prepositional phrase, giving me more. I can choose to take in the black dress. So the sentence will be, the woman. So the subject is which is a singular word, will be chosen. That is why the woman is my mother. Intervening words are just to add information. They don't change the meaning of the sentence, whether they are, when they are even taken. Just look at the true subject. And then, all right? Okay. My name is Humphrey. Humphrey is asking a question. My name is Humphrey from Arts Education Department. The rule of Concord states that a singular noun should take a singular verb and a plural noun should take a plural verb. These sentences make me to swim in the sea. Oh, Humphrey is swimming in the sea this morning. Please come back. Humphrey says, he asked this question. Question one. It has been suggested that he go away. So Humphrey, he is found in your sentence and the subject you chose is go. So Humphrey, in this sentence, he, is it singular or plural? He is a third person pronoun. And you know that third person pronouns, they always take singular verb. That's the rule in English. So the go, which is a plural verb, must be changed to the singular. You just have to add yes. So you get, he goes away. He goes away. Then your sentence two. The board has recommended that the manager resign. The board has recommended that the manager resign. I take it that you are talking about the notional concord, where we talk about collective nouns. The noun either meaning the noun being considered as a unit or individual members in the group. So the board has the verb that has been used here. So I take it that the board in this sentence is a singular noun. That is why has been taken. All right. This one is also from Mayfred Adai. I like your name, Mayfred. Wow. Mayfred Adai from Music Department. Oh, that's why you're having Mayfred. It's a singing. Mayfred. So Mayfred says, thank you for today's lesson. It was educative. But you were going too fast. Mayfred, I'm so... Two of you have said, the next time I come, I'll just slow down, okay? Thank you. Okay, so Uncle Bright, a student is asking that he's really enjoying the jazz being played on the background. So he would want to know the title of the background jazz being played. So maybe you would look for the name of the title of the jazz being played, and I would let him know later on. Okay, Uncle Bright is bringing it. So Godwin, I think that is Kenny G always. Kenny G, always. All right, so just listen to it, okay? Music is good for the soul. Oh, I want to go over the lines again. an SMS message here. We have even, I think, two of them. So, hello, I am Abdul Malik, a level 100 student from the political science department. Please, madam, can I say the president, together with his ministers, is coming? The president, together with his ministers, is coming? Yes, Abdul, you can say it. The together with is following immediately, is immediately following the president. And the president is singular here. And because it is singular, S is correct. Okay, good. And you're also asking, is it correct to say a people is coming? You have qualified people with a. So it makes it singular. So definitely you have to use the is. All right. Then the second question says, good morning, madam. I am Elias Do Abochi from Music Department. Please, should we always look for the second subject to determine the correct verb? I think you're talking about proximity concord. Wherever the verb is placed, look for the verb, look for the subject it is following. Okay? Wherever the verb is placed, if the verb is closely following a singular noun or a subject, choose a singular verb. If it's following a plural subject, choose a plural verb. I'm sure I've answered your question, Elias. Let's listen to him. Okay. Hello. Do you have a... Hello, sweetheart.
Considering an earlier call, and it's like you couldn't...
Okay, Jonathan.
My question was, do we use the single... sentence that to example in the, my father's house, let me take it again. The book in the letter stays in my father's house. Okay. I hope you get to you're getting me.
The boy and the letterer stays in my father's house. Oh, so Jonathan, let me ask you a question. The subject, what are the subjects in the sentence? Can you mention the subjects in the sentence for me? Are you still there?
Yes.
So give me the subjects in the sentence you gave me.
The boy.
Uh-huh. And what again?
The lecturer.
Very good, Jonathan. Are there two? Or it's only one in there. Good. And what did you use to join the boy and the lecturer? no. Jonathan, no. Jonathan, I'm going to buy Kenke for you so that you would listen to me attentively. Jonathan, you joined the boy, the lecturer, with and. And I told you that with pseudo conjunctions and, when you have two entities or two subjects joined by and, A-N-D, you take the plural verb. So you can't say the boy and the lecturer is, no, it's what? It's okay. something, you said something. It's always the boy and the lecturer are. Okay, Jonathan, my baby.
Okay, I've heard you, madam.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay. Hello. Yes, my dear. Yes, my dear. Good morning. Hello, my dear. You are my people, right? That's right.
Okay.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Amma, and it's like I want to use the pseudo medicine code.
Hello, my dear. Can you ask your question again? They keep breaking. Please call back 0503-923158. 0503-923158. I'll be waiting patiently. So whilst we are waiting for our friends to call or other people to call, let's recap two or three of the rules that I think are quite confusing to you. So I'll first of all go with the quasi pseudo coordinators. I said early on. I didn't say earlier on. Listen to the English again. I said early on and not earlier on. We don't say earlier on. We say early on. Or you can say I said earlier. All right? Please don't make that mistake. A lot of people do so. So I hope today we have corrected ourselves. Knowledge is power, right? So, with the quasi pseudo coordinators, we say that they are words or phrases. There's a call on that line. Okay, there's a call, right? So, my dear caller. Hello, sweetheart. Good morning. How are you? Mensa. You don't understand pseudo coordinators. Okay. So please, that was what I was even going to talk about when you called in. So you attentively, okay. Thank you. So when pseudo coordinators are phrases that cannot join two singular nouns to make them plural, just put it in your head. They are expressions, okay? They can't join two singular nouns to make them plural. So I gave you some examples like together, as well, in addition to, accompanied by, along. Including, like, no, rather than, apart from, and with exception of. Okay, so I can say that I would use one example a friend of yours used, I think maybe that will be easier for you because it's from a student. Your friend said, the president, together with his ministers, is coming. The president, together with his ministers, is coming. Now let's look at this sentence very carefully. What is the subject here? The president. The coordinator that is immediately following the president is together. Now, because singular, that together with the together with does not have any effect on the president. So, if you are here, you have the president is coming with his ministers. Do you get it? Anytime the correct answer, look at the subject that the coordinator is immediately following. Is it plural? Then take a plural. Is it singular? Then take a singular verb. I hope this time round, my people, you have understood. All right. So I'll look for another one and then I'll talk about it. Hello. Good morning. Good morning, dear. Pardon. I'm great. Can you move away from the radio? I can't really hear you well.
Okay.
Hello. Sweetheart. Please call me. I still can't hear you well. 0503 923158. Whilst we wait for him, I would like to take 2 SMS here. I am Theophilus. Is it Cole or Cole? I don't know, but forgive me. Cole. So Theophilus Colley, very good. Level 100 from Art Department. Theophilus is saying that from the experience he's had with me this morning, he would like to seize the opportunity to commend me highly for a great job done. Just save. I'm teary here. Thank you for acknowledging my work. God bless you. Then somebody is saying, can we classify mnemonics as an example of singular nouns? Mnemonics is a string of words that helps us to recall when we are studying. So, my dear, mnemonics doesn't come in here, okay? Thank you. Hello. Yeah, hello. Good morning, my dear. Move away, please, from the radio set. Oh, sweetheart. You want to... Oh, lower it. Lower the volume. Okay. You will still hear your beautiful voice, okay? Yes, please, sweetheart.
And I'm sure.
No?
Okay.
I didn't say, hold on. I said singular nouns take singular verbs. Plural nouns take plural verbs. That's what I said. No, you interchanged it, please. Yes, that is the rule. That is the rule, but you just have to look at the rule that is being where the question is coming from at the moment, whether it's based on proximity concord, notional concord. So anytime you ask the question, just look at it. If there's the answer requires a singular verb, it is because in that sentence the subject is a singular subject. Yeah, that's
all right.
All right.
Thank you.
Welcome, my dear. All right. So we go through indefinite pronouns. We want to recap. So we are looking at indefinite pronouns. And we say that indefinite pronouns that end with body. One. And thin. With examples like someone. Everyone. No one. Somebody. Everybody. Nobody. Anything. Something. And nothing are always singular and require singular verbs. I say that we have another, each, much, other, either, little, among others. These are all definite singular nouns and they must agree with singular verbs. So I have three examples here. Example one, neither of the contestants is present. Neither, either. So neither. Remember, I didn't say neither, no. The neither, nor is with proximity concord. This one is indefinite pronoun. No, no. So neither of the contestants is present. The emphasis is on neither. Each of us was given a handsome reward. Each is here, is an indefinite pronoun. So we take what is a singular verb. One of the students has been hospitalized. Then we say again that indefinite pronouns such as several, others, many, a few, and both. And require plural verbs. And early on, I took time to explain what the difference between a few and few. And I said that a few means some, whereas few means not all. A few of the books are torn, meaning some of the books are torn. Then few boys cook very well, meaning that not a lot of boys can cook. And it is true, not a lot of boys can cook. There will be a cooking competition very soon. I've got someone here who says he will come. I'm ready to eat your sumptuous meal. Okay, so my example is both girls are intelligent. Both girls are intelligent. Then we have some indefinite pronouns such as any, of, most, more, none, and some, which can either be singular or plural depending on the context they are used. The choice of the appropriate verb depends on whether they precede countable or uncountable nouns. So if you want to use any, most, of, more, none, and some, It could be plural or singular, depending on the context. All right. So, what if they precede? If they precede countable nouns, okay, we take the plural verbs. Example, most of the footballers are from Africa. Footballers are human beings that can be counted. So that's why we use the plural verb are. Example two, some of the tables are broken. Tables, countable nouns, so the plural verb are. Then when they precede uncountable nouns, they agree with singular verbs. One example is, most of the luggage in the bus is missing. Most of the luggage in the bus is missing. Luggage here is uncountable and is always going with singular verbs. So in this sentence, we had the singular verb is. Okay, good. Sentence two. All the water from the tank has drained out. All the water from the tank has drained out. Water is uncountable. So the verb has. Then I would end with expressions of time, money, and distance. So expressions of time, money, and distance usually take singular verbs. 10,000 cedis is a great deal of money. Don't say 10,000 cedis are a great deal of money. No, 10,000 cedis is a great deal of money. 5 kilometers is too far to walk. Then example three, which is the last time, and I will end my lecture. If no one calls or no one sends me a text message, 10 years is too long to finish the project. So I'm checking whether I have more messages or there'll be more calls. All right. So if you want to call, you can still call on 0503-923158. And still send messages through the same number, 0503-923158. The third rule, title of songs goes with singular verb. So my question is, if the title of a song is in plural form, do you still use singular verb? Well, the rule in grammar is a title goes with a singular verb. So whether it's in plural form or not, please use the singular verb. Thank you. Science Department says, please, my question is, I'm waiting for you and I'm waiting on you. Which one is correct? I'm waiting for you and I'm waiting on you. Okay, so Enoch, to wait on someone means to serve someone. To wait on someone means to serve someone. So an example is, the hotel staff waited on the couple at their wedding dinner. So it means the staff waited to serve them. That's something that I'm sure a lot of people are learning now. Then the second one is, to wait for something or someone means we are expecting something to happen or we are waiting for someone. Enoch, I'm sure you are okay now.
Hello.
Hello, sweetheart. Yes.
Good morning, madam.
Good morning, my dear. How are you?
Madam.
Please, can you lower the volume on your radio set?
Yes.
Okay, please. Thank you.
I have a question to ask.
Yes, please, go on. Oh, my dear, the line keeps breaking. Can you move away, or you just lower the volume on your set, or maybe you can still call back.
Okay, madam.
Okay, then speak. Yeah, speak.
I'm confused about this question. Yes, madam, is this clear?
I'm listening, please.
I'm confused. It's like economics and mathematics.
Mm-hmm.
When you use the singular verb or the plural verb, it's like they are combined. Economics and mathematics. So.
Okay, I've gotten you, okay. So, it was under rule number 6, singular nouns with plural verbs. So we say that some singular nouns look plural because they end with their plural marker S. And mathematics is an example, economics is an example. It looks plural, but it takes singular verbs. So we say, mathematics is one of my best subjects. Okay, or Emma is good at economics. The plural verb is used even though economics, the singular verb is used even though economics looks plural. Thank you.
Hello, madam.
Hello, dear. Hello.
Hello.
Yes, please. The line is breaking.
The question that I ask, the two are combined. I'm talking of economics and mathematics. Like, the two are in the same.
Okay. So you have joined. You yourself are saying you have combined. You have used and to combine them. So two separate entities, they will become R. You are talking of economics, which is different from mathematics. So you use
madam.
R. Okay, okay. That's
okay,
fine.
Madam.
You're welcome. right. The messages sent, most of them are commending me for teaching well to their understanding, and so they are happy about what they have heard today. Others too are questions that I have attended to already. So at this juncture, I think we've come to the end of our lesson on Concord relations or subjects verb agreement for today. I've really had an interesting time with you today. You've been very engaging. God bless you for listening, and do have a fruitful or blessed weekend. Bye for now.
Live on 90.3 FM, we've been listening to a radio lecture. That's for level-headed students studying the course GPDI 111 Communication Skills. And the topic was grammar and usage concord.